If you want talk, games, and fun all rolled into one, well, you've come to the right place. This is The Game Show, where host Bradley Clarke and his special guests talk about the world of television game and competition shows. But Bradley's guests aren't here to just talk. They came to play a game as well. What will today's topic be? What game does Bradley have planned? There's only one way to find out.
It's time to start the show.
You heard the man. Welcome to The Game Show. And here's your host, the Bradster himself, Bradley Clarke.
It's time to start the show yet again. Thank you, Austin Angelo, and welcome to The Game Show. And this episode is one that I've been looking forward to doing for quite some time now, as today is all about my favorite reality competition show of all time, The Amazing Race.
This is a race like no other in history. This is The Amazing Race.
This is the first Amazing Race-themed episode of The Game Show, and who better to talk to than a couple of racers loyal fans and viewers were originally introduced to on the first ever episode of the Amazing Race series way back in 2001. You might remember them for their so-called evil gameplay, although I wouldn't call it evil, I'd call it strategic instead. Their space-saving luggage techniques and their lovable team mascot. I'm, of course, talking about third-place finishers on Season 1 and true Amazing Race All-Stars. It's Joe Baldassare and Bill Bartek, Team Guido. Joe and Bill, thank you so much for joining me today on The Game Show.
Yay!
This is a treat for me because I started watching the show when I was 8 years old. And when The Amazing Race got put on reruns on The Game Show Network, I was so excited to watch this show. And you guys were running around the world, and I was just in awe of the show and your performance and what this show has done for reality television. So when I saw that you were going to compete on All Stars, and I've watched Season 1 5 times, I have the DVD set, I just rewatched it. This is a thrill for me.
Well, you've watched Season 1 more than we have.
Well, maybe not me, because I just love reality TV. So it was like a dream come true and definitely a bucket list item for me when I finally got on. I started watching reality TV with The Real World, and I knew I was too old for that. So it was amazing when I finally got cast on something, because I got to do it, first of all, with my partner. And The World was our game board. It was amazing.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm such a big fan of the show. I've not missed an episode. As I said, I've watched seasons multiple times, and on January 3rd at 8 p.m. on CBS, season 30 of The Amazing Race. Can you believe it? 30 seasons.
It's incredible.
That's,
I mean, it
unbelievable.
Really is unbelievable, yeah.
Now, I'm the one now talking to Amazing Race celebrities, but you may also be talking to an Amazing Race celebrity, and I'll tell you why. I was at the starting line when they filmed it in New York City. I went to go see them film the starting line, and I brought with me a sign because I figured signs will get you on TV. So I held up a sign that says, "Remember to read your clue or Phil might eliminate you."
That was good. There's no better advice. Yes. Read your clue. I don't know how many times they said that to us.
Yes. Don't lose the clue either.
That's true. There's been many times where people have lost their clue in passports and fanny packs.
Absolutely.
Yes, yes, yes. And we have done that ourselves.
So if you see that sign, I'm the one holding it because the camera got me a few times.
Cool. All
right, cool.
So 30 seasons ago, when you were in Central Park back in 2001 at the Bethesda Fountain waiting for Phil Kogan to say go, did you ever imagine 16 years later and 29 seasons later, people like me would still want to talk to you about The Amazing Race and that this show would still be on the air?
We get goosebumps every time we see Bethesda Fountain on TV. So to answer your question, no, we didn't. What do you think, Joe?
Yeah. It never occurred to me that it could last this long and be this popular and that we were making so much history at the time. I'm really proud to be part of it.
Yeah, when I rewatched the season one finale, and you even said it in the commentary on the DVD, when you see Robin Brennan running in Flushing Meadows Park to that heroic music, as a fan, I get goosebumps. And I'm just proud to say that I'm a fan and going back years and years of watching. I mean, this show has entranced me for half my life. And just to say that I'm a fan of the show, even though I wasn't on it, it's just such a special thing to me. Like, this show has been part of my childhood, and now going on into adulthood, this show is still with me. So as racers on the first season, you must be so proud to say that you were one of the first 11 teams, I'm assuming.
Well, we are, from the standpoint that we're so proud that our accomplishments on the show, and when I say that, I mean everyone that produced it, the contestants, everyone, made it happen, because believe me, if you were there, you wouldn't believe what a crazy, I don't want to use any foul language, but it was,
mishmash.
It was just unbelievable good luck that they were able to pull it off. I mean, there was plenty of money there. That wasn't the problem, but it's a traveling show of more than 250 production people. And when they said go, they unleashed this incredible energy, and they had no idea that we were going to do what we did. I mean, everything they planned for, every contingency they had was out the window, and they had to hire everybody they could. They didn't have enough production people to handle what we unleashed at them, because we were going like 3 to 4 days ahead of schedule.
Another example is that we didn't even know what the name of the show was until the morning of, when we all got to get on this big giant bus driving around New Jersey and everything else, and eventually ending up in Central Park. And on the front of the bus said, "The Amazing Race." And we all just kind of looked up at it and said, "Well, I guess that's the name of the show." Because nobody had ever told us before.
So the audition process, I believe I've read somewhere that one of the teams, it could have been you, it could have been another team, that they saw a clipping in a newspaper about a new show about traveling around the world. Is that how you found out about the show?
No, I had applied for Survivor, didn't get any callbacks or anything. So I just kept watching TV, because it was the second season of Survivor and it was the first season of Big Brother. So I was watching Big Brother, and in the after hours stuff that they had online, they had an advertisement on that link. And it said, "Join the CBS Summer Global Adventure Series. You and a partner can travel the world and experience new things, blah, blah, blah." You know, it's like one of those come-ons to submit an application. So I proposed it to Joe as a way to do this together. If I played Survivor, I'd be all by myself and he'd kind of be left behind. We love to travel and play games, and this was something that we could do together. So it was just like it was made for us.
And don't you love that The Amazing Race started season 1 in New York City, and now season 30 of The Amazing Race is also starting in New York City? I mean, I'm thrilled because I'm a New Yorker, but it just brings back that nostalgia feeling, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, well,
absolutely.
Yeah, Joe's a New Yorker from the Hudson Valley.
Nice.
I'm from the Hudson Valley, yeah.
All right.
But nobody knows where it is. It's halfway, it's 60 miles north of New York City, right above West Point.
That's still New York to me.
It's still New York to me, too.
Yeah, I mean, when we were lined up there, the electricity of that start line was palpable. And, you know, there's $1 million at stake here. And the minute Phil said go, you just didn't think of anything but getting to that finish line. And not like Survivor, there was no one to prevent you from getting there first. There was no game playing,
voting, and no
and no alliances, no nothing. And it was really exciting because all you had to do was be the fastest. That was the whole thing of the game.
Yeah, and later on I want to talk about some of the new elements, because your first season was just get to the finish line. There's more gameplay involved now, so I'll get to that a little bit later. But sticking on Central Park, every time I go to Central Park, every time I go anywhere, I always have to find the Amazing Race hotspots. So
that's amazing.
You need to be on the show.
Well, next year I could apply. You have to be 21 to be on the show. So hopefully it will make it to a new season so that I could apply. I was just in Washington, D.C. over the summer. And you remember back in the Family Edition where they had a run with the briefcases? Mm-hmm. I was running around the tidal basin. The sky is blue. The sea is green.
God. We just drove past the Salt Lake Library. You remember that?
That was a pit stop.
With the big arch staircase and everything. And I was offering Bill to just stop the car and he can just go run up there for a little while, recreate it.
Yeah.
That was Family Edition also.
Right. That was a non-elimination with the Weaver family.
Yeah.
Wow, you're good.
Yeah.
And then this summer we were in Paris and we walked by the tea shop where Kevin and Drew spent the night. We just happened to be just walking down the street and I turned around and I said, "Oh my gosh, it's Tate Ferrier's." And I said, that was season 1.
So when I go to the fountain, I'll pull out my phone and look up the picture to make sure, okay, Joe and Bill were there, Kevin and Drew were there. Even when I go to the Unisphere in Flushing Meadows Park where the first season ended, I always make sure to find the spot where the mat was. I know it's on the Africa side. I'm a bit obsessed with this show, if you can tell.
No, so are we.
Really?
I mean, we're as much of fans of it as you are. We probably don't have the best knowledge of it like you do, but we just love it.
Well, I hope you have some knowledge of the race, because later on we're going to play a game, and it's about Amazing Race trivia.
Get that book. Where's my My ox is broken.
You have the book, My Ox is Broken?
Yeah, yes. Someplace we have it, but God knows where.
And for those listening, My Ox is Broken is a famous quote from season 5 by a man named Colin, who is in the Philippines doing a challenge. And he had to maneuver an ox to try to find a little rope in the mud field with his clue. And he said, my ox is broken.
Where is he going? No, in this field. Oh, my God. My ox is broken.
And in that book is almost every major accomplishment or funny thing that's happened in the race, in the history of the race.
Yeah.
All the places they've been.
Right, yeah. So going back to season 1, I've always wanted to ask you this. Do you ever think back to Bangkok on whether if you would have taken the cab ride, you might have won the race?
We call it our $1 million bus ride.
Yeah.
Because it absolutely made the difference. I mean, there was still a flip of the coin of what would have happened once we got to New York City, but we think we would have had a very good chance.
One of the things that we decided in advance is that we were never going to take the fast forward. There was one every leg of the race, and they told us before the show started that at the end, if everybody has taken a fast forward, then we can institute another fast forward for like the last leg. And we thought that would really be unfair that somebody could just kind of jump to the head of the pack and win the whole show. So Bill and I decided in advance we were never going to do it. And then if everybody else had done it, well, then the last one is just waiting for us and we'll just not use it or whatever. And then when we got to Bangkok, we got scared because it just kind of came down to Emily and Nancy and us. And we kind of got chicken and decided to go for it. And had we not done that and just let them do the fast forward, we could have done the other thing, was looking for the license plate and the tigers and everything else, and probably taken a cab ride down to Krabi rather than getting to a bus station by ourselves and taking a bus. And the funny part about it is that when we got to the bus station, we were standing in line getting a ticket and we're checking out everything. And this really, really sweet Thai lady was behind us. And she wanted to know what we're doing and where we're going. And we said, we're going to this place called Krabi. And she says, oh, I'm going to Krabi too. It's like 1,000 kilometers away. And we said, well, we can either take a cab or we can take a bus or we could take the train. She said, well, she's really being helpful. And she says, well, you've already missed the train. So forget the train. And nobody could ever take a taxi cab that far because it costs too much money. So you have to take a bus and you've already missed the first bus. So we're all getting in line for tickets for the second bus. It doesn't leave for another 6 hours or whatever. And all we had to do was walk on the other side of the sliding glass doors outside and ask a cabbie, how much does it cost to go to Krabi, which is about $140. And we had the money. So we just believed what she had to say because she was so sweet. And she didn't have $140 to take a taxi ride, but we did. And we could have taken a taxi cab ride and beat everybody else there by about 6 hours. And we didn't do it.
Well, that's interesting. You actually taught me something that I didn't actually know. So if everyone took the fast forward, they would have instituted another one on the last leg?
They could have. Production had the option of instituting new fast forwards.
That doesn't mean they would have, but they had the option.
Yeah. At the very beginning, there were essentially no ways of a contestant trying to manipulate the race. But this was one that you could just hold out and not do a fast forward. And that meant nobody else could ever do a second one. And if you remember, in the beginning of the show, everybody who came in first place for about the first 5 or 6 episodes, they were always the people who did the fast forward.
Right.
We almost always came in second, but we didn't use the fast forward until Bangkok.
And not only were you smart enough to save your fast forward, you two were also smart enough to figure out that just by first impressions and instincts alone, eventual winners of season 1, Robin Brennan, would be in the final 3 with you guys.
We picked Margarita Frank also.
Right, yeah. You were really the first alliance of the Amazing Race. You three.
Right.
Right, right.
And we were first to break it.
Alliances don't work so well on this show.
Right, yeah, it's different than Survivor.
For one thing, when you're running around airports and now suddenly the 3 teams are going to go running up and get all on the same plane and everything else, you're having to find 12 seats because everybody's got a cameraman and a sound man with them too. So you're really traveling around like a family of 4 rather than just 2.
Right.
And it's incredibly difficult to do that. And it's just too cumbersome to try to coordinate 6 people all to behave themselves.
What we decided is not making an alliance with a strong team, but making an alliance with a weaker team. And of course, everybody's done that since. You know, if you're helping a weak team move along, then you, of course, can
bounce out somebody else. and then cream them at the end.
Of course, when it really counts.
Yeah, yeah. Typical that's, team that's, Guido evilness.
That's the other way that you can manipulate the show. And that's the only two ways.
Yeah, when I talk to people about, what's the difference between Amazing Race and Survivor? I said, well, Survivor, there's more things that you can do in terms of changing the way the game is played. With Amazing Race, it's clue. The only really thing you can do is U-turns now, or yield back then, or small stuff like what you just mentioned.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. And none of those things were available in Amazing Race 1 other than a fast forward, of which we had one every single leg in the beginning.
Right.
Or so, like Rob and Amber, they kind of ingeniously figured out if everyone takes a penalty, then it's sort of the tables stay even, and maybe somebody that's really bad off comes in later and gets eliminated. So that's another way you can manipulate it. If you can talk people into doing something like, you know, hanging out and just giving up on one of the tasks.
Like, I don't want to eat 5 pounds of meat or whatever in Argentina or whatever it was.
So I was going to ask you, when you saw that Robin Brennan took the fast forward on the very first leg, did you think that was a bad decision?
Yes.
Yes. Uh-huh. I go, what are you doing?
And so did they once they saw that. When they watched the show, because we went to their apartment in Los Angeles to watch it, you should have heard. I mean, they were just furious that they didn't get to jump off the Patoka Gorge cliff.
Yeah.
And they thought, what a waste of our advantage.
They totally wasted their fast forward possibility because they only entered into the Songhue village about 15 to 20 minutes before we did. I mean, we were still cooking the egg and eating the egg while they arrived and went in, and we were right behind them.
Which is a roadblock that was never aired. The ostrich egg thing in season one wasn't shown.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That didn't show.
Right. Yeah. It's on the DVD set. I've seen it.
Correct. Yeah,
yeah,
correct.
Yeah, yeah.
It tastes just like regular eggs. It's just like a dozen eggs instead of one egg.
Yeah,
right.
It's 2 dozen eggs.
2 dozen. Okay, yeah.
Yeah. Which is really good that we did it because both of us ate the equivalent of 12 eggs, and then we didn't eat anything else for the rest of the day. And that night they had a party in Songhue Village for all the production and the crew, and a whole bunch of people got ptomaine poisoning.
Oh, my God, really?
Including one cameraman
who was sent home. We went to bed.
You were strategizing for the next leg.
We were.
When the next leg was starting at midnight.
Right.
Yeah. We didn't even know that there was a party there. Eventually, when we got to Paris, a couple people had to go to the hospital on the production staff. So a 12-hour layover turned into a 24-hour layover because we had to wait for a couple of cameramen to come out of the hospital.
And that's just one of the things that was a setback on that season, from sandstorms to...
There were a lot of them.
Yes.
It's amazing how that race actually got from start to finish.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely
it is.
So when you were in Alaska and you read that Robin Brennan won the race, so you got to do the dog sled, but after that, what happened? Did you fly to New York?
When we got to the road, that dog sled went across a big field and river and stuff. You couldn't see it because it was all under snow. We got to the road that takes us back into
Anchorage,
yeah, because it was about a two-hour drive back to Anchorage. And they told us on the way that we were going to just collect all of our stuff. And they got us a hotel room so we could shower and change everything because the race is technically over, and then get ready for the flight back to New York.
Yeah. We flew Anchorage to Seattle to New York.
Since the race ended, have you ever gone to the Unisphere in Flushing Meadows Park just to say that you crossed the finish line?
No.
That's kind of a sore spot.
But I'm old enough. I went there to the New York World's Fair in 1964, so I know exactly what it's like.
Right, yeah.
There's some things that we really don't want to create. Thank you very much.
I was going to say, if you're ever in New York, and I can be your Phil if you want, and we can recreate it, you can run, and
okay,
I'll say
we
you're...
can do that. Yeah,
we'll take you up
on that. Fine. If you're ever in Thailand with us, we can go look up that lady.
Perfect.
Told us to take the bus.
I'll officially greet you as team number 3. We'll find the spot, and you can come running up. I'll get the heroic music in the background.
Really? We've been to Bethesda many times. Bethesda really does have a lot of fond memories for us. It really is a special place.
Do you two still keep in contact with any of the other teams you raced with on season 1?
Well, really, just about everybody. I'm like the greeter for all the teams that have just left the race. I try to send everybody a message, you know, like, welcome to the Amazing Race alumni. You know, it's a very exclusive club.
Right.
But it's hard not to know people because you really have so much in common. So just like a month ago, Justin and his wife, Diana, they were in Honolulu. So we went out to dinner with them. So anytime somebody comes through Hawaii or occasionally we've seen people here in Park City. That's where we are right now. And you have so much in common. You just get together and you just start talking about the race because you just kind of want to know what the latest is and how things are handled. And, you know, because there's always something that happens in every race that's interesting to hear. And there's always a thread of somebody who's still there that's really been around almost since the beginning.
You mentioned Justin and Diana from season 27. I met them at the starting line. They were there.
Cool. Yeah, I know. They're very sweet people. Wonderful.
And a little spoiler for all of my loyal listeners on the game show. I'm actually going to have them on the show as well.
Cool.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. Well, say hello to them for us.
I will. Yeah. I will definitely. All right. So I want to talk about Amazing Race All-Stars, season 11, true All-Stars. We'll get into season 24 in a second. But when you first saw who was competing alongside you, were there any teams that you said to yourself, why are they here? Or were there any teams that you figured were going to be there but weren't actually on the race?
Yeah.
Well, the one thing is I'm wondering why are they here were Eric and Danielle because they weren't a team.
All right, that's on my list, too.
A composite of two other teams or whatever, and supposedly they had dated, or they were dating, and it turns out I think they probably had a couple of dates or whatever. And so that they were a team that was just kind of stuck together, and that didn't quite make a whole lot of sense to me. Everybody, I think, in the room when we all just kind of saw one another and who were selected, were all kind of fixated on Rob and Amber and Uchenna and Joyce. But if you can also remember that Riken was dating Lance Bass at the time. And that was getting lots of press and everything else. So I was thinking, well, wouldn't it be interesting if they can create a team for Eric and Danielle? Wouldn't it be interesting if they created another team for Riken and Lance Bass? So then in the meeting, I asked Bertram when he was kind of introducing everybody and telling us what's going on. I specifically asked, is this everybody who's going to be on the race? And he said, yes, this is everybody. There's nobody else that's going to be coming in, like maybe after the first episode, because they can make up their own rules. So they could just do whatever they want.
Well, I'm so glad they didn't pull a Big Brother and brought in contestants to enter the race after the first episode, because in my mind, that would have ruined the integrity of not only the All-Star season, but the Amazing Race as a competition itself.
Yeah, it was bad enough that they brought in the two that they did, you know, that they were just boyfriend, girlfriend. They weren't really a former team. But, you know, we were expecting people like Colin and Christy. And, you know, there were certain people I was kind of surprised that weren't there. But then we found out later why some of those people didn't participate. And they might have been asked. Yeah. We don't know for sure. But, yeah, it was a good group of people. We knew that we were up against some really strong competition.
Right. Well, Colin and Christy were asked, but Christy was pregnant at the time.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm.
They're probably one of my favorite teams.
They're good.
You know, they set the record at one time for the most number of first places at 6. Brad fact! And I'm glad they're still together.
they're a wonderful couple.
So is Eric and Danielle the only team that you said, why are they here?
Yes.
For Amazing Race All-Stars, yes. There was a couple times when Danielle just wanted to quit the race and just go home. Which we were saying, that's a great idea.
Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead. Well, first time happened in Johannesburg Airport. Next time happened in Zanzibar. And a couple times we were right at the very bottom of the pack with the two of them. And it's a testament to how honest the Amazing Race is, because we were hours and hours behind everybody else. And it was just Billy and me and Eric and Danielle right at the very bottom, going from Africa to Warsaw. And then around Warsaw and everything else, we got eliminated by their maneuvering, which was very clever on their part. I don't blame them at all. And they actually won the thing. I mean, it was just incredible that they hung on this whole time and fought their way up. At that point in time, they would have been team number 6 out of 6, I think. And they actually won. Stuff like that doesn't happen on Survivor.
Very true. Also, I just remembered another team, which is why I'm surprised that Eric and Danielle did get picked, because they were both from season 9. I was sure that when I heard that they were doing All-Stars, that BJ and Tyler, the winners of season 9, were going to be on.
Right.
Yes. We were surprised that they weren't.
Yeah, I kind of think they were trying not to put too many, you know, it's a little bit of salt and pepper and, you know, all these different ingredients, and it's a complicated mix. And I think it turned out when Colin and Christy didn't come in, and, you know, there were certain things that were happening and not happening, and they had to make decisions at the last minute to make it come together.
Right. You mentioned Poland and Warsaw. When you fell 12 hours behind in Poland, did the horror of deja vu set in?
It was exactly that. We just went, oh my God, it's all happening again.
Yeah.
Yeah, when I was watching that, I felt bad for you, because as a loyal fan and someone who wanted you so bad to finish the race in season 1, and to see this again happening to one of my favorite teams was so disheartening.
Yeah, it really was. We thought, is this going to happen again where we don't even get to cross the finish line? It was just horrible.
And there were weird things happening. On that night when we were eliminated, you had two things to do. You could make kielbasa or make bagels. And we're riding around Krakow with cab drivers that are not from Krakow, so they don't know where they're going. We have to tell them where to go. And we couldn't find the bagel-making place. Eric and Danielle are following us like two little puppy dogs. We just can't shake them off our tails. So they're just in another cab following our cab. And eventually we give up and say, okay, let's just go make kielbasa instead. We find that place. And this is probably one of the only time that I can think of where you actually have to do it, your roadblock, with another team. So otherwise, you just do it on your own, and you're either first or you're last or whatever. But there, you were a group of four, so that not only did we have to complete the task, but so did Eric and Danielle. And Eric used his brains and said, I'm just going to make believe I'm sick and I'm throwing up and I can't do this and I'm going to take my time or whatever, making sure that the beauty queens and Myrna and Shmurna get ahead of us. And we'll come in third and eliminate Joe and Bill. And that's exactly what happened.
And the irony of that story is that after the race ended, we're in San Francisco, the Beauty Queens took me aside and said they were waiting for us at the church where we were to get our clue and go on to the next leg. They were actually waiting for us. They wanted to work with us. And it just killed me that we didn't get there.
Rather than Myrna and Shmurna. But we didn't arrive soon enough, so they just kind of took the other two. And that's only because we were wasting time looking for the bagel-making factory, which we never did find.
Right, and that whole thing where two teams combined, that was the intersection back in season 11. So that brings me to my next point. I want to talk about when you competed on season one, as I said before, it was kind of like a bare season because it was first starting out. There was no real elements to the game besides the fast forward element. So season 11, you have the yield, you have the intersection, you have the marked for elimination if it's a non-elimination leg. You had actual clue boxes. You had Phil at the mat for you. It was such a different vibe. Did you feel a different vibe when you were racing besides the teams being all-stars and competitive, but just the vibe of the race itself?
We really felt out of it because we weren't used to all those game elements, and that's bad on us that we didn't research everything as much as we could. I mean, they did introduce some new things, but it really behooved us to try to figure out and rewatch some of the seasons that happened just before ours to make sure we understood those elements. But it really hurt us because all of the people we were racing against did understand those elements.
Yeah. In season one, one of the rules were you go up and you do all your research for airplanes and everything else. And once you buy your airplane ticket, you're stuck with that airplane ticket. You can't change it. And this had just kind of been inbred in us so that you did all careful research and then you went up and bought your ticket for four, not two. And it's paid for with a Visa card by the sound man. And that's it, man. By the time you got to season 11, you could keep going and going and working it and working it and just keep buying tickets and trying to work any possible angle to try to get to your destination faster, even though you've got a whole pocket load of tickets. So when we were in the Johannesburg airport, it was during the Hajj, and all the flights were totally booked, so we could not get to Tanzania very easily at all. It took us like 36 hours to get from Johannesburg to Tanzania. We had to sleep in the airport in a company lounge there. And we had so many tickets that I just took a big giant sheet of computer paper and made a big spreadsheet of this flight. We've got these tickets and it's going to get that time and these tickets going to get some other time, blah, blah, blah. And when we counted it up, I had in my backpack $50,000 worth of airplane tickets.
Wow.
Of which we used one set of airplane tickets, which was probably about $5,000 of airplane tickets. And when you get to Dar es Salaam, you just give $45,000 of airplane tickets back to the production guy, and they'll go get the money back. These are the sort of things that we didn't catch on to until about halfway through Amazing Race All-Stars, where the people who had been on Amazingness 4, 5, 6, they had changed the rules already, so they were kind of in tune with this sort of behavior.
Well, not only that, but Danny and Ozzy had a travel agent
in Miami,
in Florida, so they could book their flights very easily through that service.
Which we never understood how that was not against the rules. But they actually ran out of money making phone calls.
Oh, wow.
Back to the States. Yeah, they actually had to beg for money from other contestants just to keep going.
And that wasn't even the penalty at the time with the money.
No.
Well, I guess not. No.
That's kind of ironic.
No. Yeah, they changed that. I don't think you can have a travel agent and all that. That was something I guess the attorneys didn't even realize was a possibility. But they were pretty sharp to come up with that little angle because it wasn't against the rules.
Right. Well, they changed it again. Now you can only buy one set of tickets.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, that leads me to my next question I wanted to ask. The race has really changed quite a bit since you ran it. I mean, just from the production dates itself, your race was over a month, and now it's down to 21 days. So are there any elements that you wish would have been part of the race when you were first doing it? Or are there any elements that you see now that you're saying, why do they do that now?
I don't like the mark for elimination. I don't like that element, but I'm sure there's a reason why they do it.
My biggest complaint is it's almost 100% taxicab rides now. Is that when we were doing it, there's many days where we had a car rented for us, like an SUV or something, and you've got a map, and you have to figure out what you're doing and where you're going by your own. You have to have a driver and a navigator, which are your teammates, and you really have to figure out all these things on your own and asking people, you know, on the street what to do and where to go, and having a lot more interaction with the native people around there rather than just piling into the back of a taxi cab and just kind of screaming at the driver all the time, it's a race, it's a race.
But I can tell you that that's probably a function of getting it done in 21 days. You know, they take as much of the element of chance out of the picture if they know they can control the teams when they'll arrive and when they'll depart. That's a function of some things that happened in season one. I mean, Joe and I were a result of that. I mean, that they have the airport bunching is a direct result of our sleeping in Thailand. They don't give the contestants that much leeway. I mean, when we got on All Stars, you get a sheet or two sheets of instructions on what you can and can't do traversing your route in that leg of the race. And now it's, I think, even more. I think Justin and Diana said it's like 4 pages of instructions. So
we got none.
As a matter of fact, we got clues that were, frankly, cryptic. They were really interesting.
Yeah,
they
riddles.
Rhymed riddles, and we got a flag, and that's where we're going.
When we're in Les Baux, France, for the next leg, the clue was one of these little flags with a little stick on it, and it basically said, go to this country. It was a red flag with a crescent moon, and all we could figure out was, okay, well, it's a Muslim country. And we had to go running around trying to figure out, what country is this? And finally somebody said, that's Tunisia. I could just imagine somebody ending up going to Turkey by mistake or something, you know?
And what's interesting now is, on the race now, if you were given a clue like that, you can just ask someone for their phone to look up flags of the world.
Yep,
yes,
you're right.
Exactly right.
You couldn't do that, that's for sure, in season one.
Yeah.
Or the internet.
You mentioned also the mark for elimination. They got rid of that actually after All Stars. It was only a 2-season thing. Brad fact.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now it's the speed bump for
Right. But you're still picking a team to get rid of.
Right.
Right. You have U-turns and a whole bunch of other
things. You're so good. There's so many new elements I can't keep track of.
There was no penalty for the first 4 seasons. Then you had the strip the money, which led to the strip the money and strip the bags.
Yeah. Right, right.
And then your season and season 10 was the mark for elimination, which I thought was the worst of them all. And since season 12, it's been the speed bump.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
And I understand why they have to do that. It's like any television show. You have to change things up and keep it new, because otherwise the teams know exactly what they need to do. And it's not interesting if everybody's just running from point A to point B. You have to have some element of surprise in the game. And I guess that's the element.
Right. And one of my biggest complaints relates to what you were saying about the control that the producers now have with the time. I think that it's too much of teams arriving at the same time or 1 minute apart. There needs to be, I think, separation, because if there's no separation, then teams from behind can't catch up.
Right. Well, I'll tell you one thing, just in the logistics of the cost of producing a show like The Amazing Race, they almost don't have a choice now, because the networks and the production companies are so strapped for cash and airtime and everything with Amazing Race, they can produce a season, and sometimes they're waiting for 6 months to get a time slot to fall into. So they don't even know that the show that they produced was actually going to produce revenue from commercials. So, you know, I can understand why they want to control it as much as possible, because controlling where the contestants are and what they're doing saves dollars. It's very expensive to do a season of the race. You know, from that perspective, if there was some way to balance the two, I don't think that there's a way to do that, because of the so many unknowns when you have a traveling production show.
And all this craziness that's going on in the world, it's impressive that the show is still on.
Yeah, it is, because it's that fact alone, what you just said, is really amazing.
So in season 24, I'm not counting Unfinished Business, because even though that was technically an all-star season, it wasn't labeled as all-stars. But then you have season 24. When it's labeled all-stars, this gets me worried when you see the lineup of these teams. So when you first saw the teams for Amazing Race All-Stars 2, what did you think?
I thought everybody is from Amazing Race 12 and on.
That's the first thing that I said. I said, if you're going to do All-Stars, this is one of my pet peeves with Survivor as well, or really any other reality show that does All-Stars, is they concentrate, I feel, on the newer people because people are going to remember them. And also they concentrate on people that have played together so that you can get maybe another argument or, you know, this one voted out this one. Let's see what they're going to do again. What they needed to do was put people like you guys or people from the first 10 seasons and put them in there, because if you're saying that these 11 teams are the sole All-Stars from seasons 1 through 23, come on. You have people like you guys who are real All-Stars. And, you know, people like...
Thank you.
Sorry that I'm ranting on this, but this gets me wound up.
I can tell. Oh, it's perfectly fine because it got us wound up also.
And what really got me annoyed was when the show brought back the Globetrotters, the Cowboys, and Margie and Luke to race for a third time, but they didn't invite any teams from the original All-Stars to race for a third time.
Yeah, it's hard to sit back and watch. But, you know, I kind of get what they're after. I don't think it's stunt casting in the true sense, but I do think they're looking for contestants that bring an audience. And the later seasons have social media backing, whereas, you know, I'm just struggling to have like 2,000 followers. A lot of these people have 30, 50,000 followers, and they're looking for people that have some kind of metered rating that they can do individually on each contestant on, you know, what kind of Nielsen rating they bring to the show. There's a way they actually can do that. I know they had it for our season because we used to have lunch with one of the CBS people and he was talking candidly about it. I mean, it wasn't like it was anything he would show me on paper, but he just definitely said, we know that people like you and they like watching you and you're the villains, but, you know, they really enjoy watching you. So there is a way that the networks can tell who brings revenue to the show. That's really what it's about.
On the flip side of that, though, when they had the season with all the internet stars and everything else, their audience size wasn't any bigger than anybody else's for the prior years.
Right.
We're all pulling in around 9 to 12 million people a week or whatever, and theirs was no larger than anybody else's, even though they had hundreds of thousands of internet followers.
See, that's why I wanted to have you on the game show, because I want to express that teams like you need to be back on the race. Originals.
Yes, we support that.
Well, you know, we have met so many people that say, oh, we love The Amazing Race, but we don't remember you. It's like, when were you on? So we were on number one, and we're on number 11. That was All-Stars. Oh, I didn't start watching until 14. So we could be Jack Benny, as far as they're concerned.
Well, I've been known to have an old soul. I'm not calling you old. That's why I like to say originals.
Yes. Well, yeah, we say
well,
Amazing
we could be
Race.
Old.
I always say that. When somebody says, what season? I say TAR, the original. You know, it's not season one. It was the show the way it was originally conceived. And that's a big difference than the way it's run now. That first season had magic.
One of the satisfying things, if it wasn't for Bill and Joe and Kevin and Drew, there probably would have never been season two.
It was
these hundreds of other contestants, they'll never thank us or whatever, or never acknowledge that. But it is the God's honest truth, is that the four of us essentially saved this show, especially after 9/11.
Well, I want to say thank you for saving the show.
Oh, you're welcome. My little grandchild.
So let's talk about the 30th season, which is premiering, as I said before, January 3rd. Is there anything that you're looking forward to for season 30? Anything that you hope to see?
Yeah, the Big Brother contestants getting eliminated early.
Oh, yeah. When I saw them at the starting line, they already looked snobby.
Big Brother is such a different show. I mean, you have this pristine environment that you're living in, and it's like a boiling pot, just like Survivor, because you're kind of like with these contestants constantly, 24 hours a day. It's not going to be that situation at all, and it'll be interesting to see how they handle it. It's a very stressful environment, the race.
Have you read up on who the teams are?
No, I'm sorry, we haven't. I don't do that until about a week before. I used to do that well in advance. I used to read every line about everything, but we're further and further removed from that, which was our life where people were constantly interviewing us and all of that stuff that died down 10 years ago. But you
except
know,
for today.
I know, it's
exactly right.
We were a big shock about why do you want to interview us?
We could even see this, like when we go out and we went and had dinner with Justin and Diana, it's really a big part of their lives right now. And it's kind of like the focal point of their existence versus after 10 to 15 years, so much has happened and you've moved on to such a degree that it's a part of your beautiful history. But I'm not eagerly anticipating or I'm not reading up on who's going to be the teams next time.
It really changed my life. I can honestly say that. And I told Elise and Bert that, you know, I thank them for really making me who I am today, but it doesn't have the fascination as much as it used to. I really enjoy watching it and seeing how people handle it, but yeah, it's not quite the same.
We knew a bunch of people that afterwards they quit their jobs and they moved to Los Angeles and they're all going to become movie stars and talk show hosts and everything else. And you see them a year or two afterwards and it's like they're just kind of existing in L.A. parking cars.
Right.
And waiting tables, you know, like 5 million other people.
Well, you guys are celebrities to me. You guys are heroes to me.
So when are we going to get to see you on our TV? We want to see how you do. I mean, it's that unique thing that everyone has to try. If you're as invested in it as you seem, I mean, you have an incredible depth of knowledge, which is excellent for the way the race is run now. You need to get on.
Actually, you could see a split second of me in the promo. They released the promo.
Is that right?
At the 12-second mark, if you pause it, I'm right above Phil's head when he says go.
Okay.
Well, Joe and Bill, we have talked about the Amazing Race. We've talked about trivia of the Amazing Race. But now it's time to put your Amazing Race trivia to the test. Are you ready to play a game?
Yes. We love games.
It's time for the game of the day.
Game of the day.
And today's game is called the Fast-Paced Race. The Fast-Paced Race.
I don't know for two old guys. That's going to be a tough one.
So when you were traveling around the world on Amazing Race 1, it took over 30 days. But today, from the comforts of your home, Joe and Bill, if all goes well with this game, you'll be traveling to about the same amount of destinations around the world in the matter of minutes. Can you believe it?
Wow.
Good deal.
So here's how we played the Fast-Paced Race. Just like on Seasons 1 and 11, there is going to be 13 legs. And for each leg, I'm going to give you the choice of two destinations to travel to, each of which corresponds with a multiple-choice trivia question. All the questions pertain to a moment from a past Amazing Race season or leg featuring that location. So you'll pick a destination, I'll read the question, and you'll have some time to discuss and think about your answer before giving it to me. Now, your goal is to make it through all 13 legs without getting four questions wrong, symbolizing the four non-elimination legs.
Oh, great. Okay.
In addition, one of the destinations is a fast forward, which means on that destination, we'll go straight to the next leg. We'll fast forward you to the next leg.
Yippee.
Okay.
And also, there is a U-turn on one of the destinations, which means that you'll have to go back to the previous leg and answer the unanswered question before continuing on to the next leg.
Okay.
So that's all the rules. Are you ready to play?
Yes.
Then let's start the Fast-Paced Race. And because Johannesburg, South Africa was the first ever destination traveled to on the Amazing Race, the background music for this game will be Africa by Toto.
Great.
And to officially start, I have to channel my inner Phil Kogan. Joe and Bill, the world is waiting for you. Good luck. Travel safe. Go! And we are off and running. Let's start leg one. Your first two destination choices are Argentina or Brazil?
Joe,
I'll take Argentina.
You're good with Argentina?
I agree.
All right, here we go. Here comes your first question. Leg one, Argentina. And luckily, we actually mentioned this before, coincidentally. A famous roadblock challenge during leg three of season 7. Now, keep in mind, audience, they have no idea what these questions are. A famous roadblock challenge during leg three of season 7 required participating teammates to eat how many pounds of traditional Argentinian feast meat? A, 3, B, 4, C, 5, or D, 6?
Isn't it C, Joe?
Yeah, I said 5 before. I think it's either 5 or 6. I'll just go for 5.
C.
Are you going to lock in C5?
Oh, God.
Final answer. Is it 6?
No, it's not 6.
Oh. Okay.
And unfortunately, it's not 5 either. It's 4.
Oh.
4. Oh, okay.
Oh, my God. We already got one wrong.
First one wrong, but that's okay. Let's start fresh on leg 2, okay?
Okay.
Here comes leg 2. Peru or Chile?
Chile.
Chile, okay. Here comes your question. Leg 2, Chile. After completing the roadblock during leg 1 in Valparaiso, Chile, teams had to travel down the hillside by what means on season 16? A, by foot, B, by funicular, C, by zipline, or D, by horse and carriage?
Yikes. Was it Zipline, Joe?
Let's say Zipline.
You're going to say Zipline?
Yeah.
Are you locking in Zipline?
I hate when you say that. I remember the episode, but I can't remember how they got down. It was a long way. Was one of the choices walking?
By foot, by funicular, by zipline, or by horse and carriage?
By foot.
Yeah, I think it was foot. I think I remember a long road that they had to walk down, like a long windy road. Let's do foot. We'll lock that in.
Locking in foot. And it is not zipline.
Oh, good.
Well, that's good.
Didn't make sense.
But it was by funicular, B.
Oh, I was going to say that, too. That was my third choice.
We're terrible at this game. Too wrong.
Too wrong.
Oh, my God. Go ahead.
I have faith in you. I have faith in you. Here comes your leg three. South Africa or Madagascar?
South Africa.
South Africa.
Here comes your question. Leg three, South Africa. After traveling to Cape Town, South Africa during leg three of season two, the teams had to make their way to what island where Nelson Mandela's prison cell was located?
Oh, thank God. We're going to get one right.
A, Robben Island. B, Mercury Island. C, Marion Island. Or D, Dyer Island.
Yeah, okay, Robben. We knew that.
Robben Island.
Are you locking that in?
Yes.
Lock it.
And there is your first correct answer. It is Robben Island.
Oh, thank God. Not Easter Island.
Has everybody tuned out already?
No, they're wide awake and ready for leg four.
Okay.
Here comes your choices for leg four. Egypt or Ethiopia?
Ugh. I think Egypt would be easier than Ethiopia. Yeah, Egypt.
Egypt?
Mm-hmm.
Alrighty. Here comes your question. Where was the leg five pit stop located in Egypt during season five? A, the Sphinx. B, the Tower of Cairo. C, the Great Pyramid. Or D, the Nile River.
It was either the pyramid or the Sphinx, because I remember the pictures of Phil standing in front of it.
You have to answer. I don't remember.
I'm going to say the Sphinx, because I sort of remember Phil standing. I remember promotional pictures of that. I'm going to say the Sphinx.
Are you going to lock in the Sphinx?
Yeah. It's probably the Great Pyramid. But...
Well, you said it was probably the Great Pyramid, and that's actually wrong. The Sphinx is the right answer.
Yeah! Oh, my God. I don't even remember anybody going to Egypt.
That's the only time they went. They've only been once, I think.
That
right?
is correct. I've read somewhere that they said that Egypt is off the map for them because, I guess, they can't get in.
Yeah, they won't go to Tunisia again either.
So you have two in a row.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. We're on a roll.
Moving on to leg five. Of 13, and you have two wrong, but let's not think about that.
No.
Right.
Your leg five destination choices are England or France?
France.
I figured that you might go with that one.
Yeah.
Here comes your France question. As you might recall, Joe and Bill, the Arc de Triomphe in Paris was the pit stop location during leg two of season one.
We sort of remember that.
We remember that.
I hope that rings a bell.
Yeah.
Billy put his butt print on the mat there.
Almost my face print.
That's right. Almost, well, because it was pouring out that day.
Yeah.
Yes, it was.
The Arc de Triomphe was also the pit stop location during the sixth leg of what season? A, 21, B, 22, C, 26, or D, 27?
Oh my God. I think it was later, so it was like the 26 of 27, because it seems like it was
picket. I have no idea.
Well, it wasn't as recent as 27. I think, I'm going to say 26.
Are you locking in 26?
Well, yeah, I don't have any choice.
Locking in 26. You were right. It was either 26 or 27.
But it's 27.
And it is 27, yeah.
Oh!
Damn.
Oh my God, I only got one more to go.
Next time you see Justin and Diana, that was their season, and they were at that pit stop.
Oh,
is that right?
God.
Yep. Well, actually, 27, that season, they did a lot of nostalgia things.
They did.
Things.
You're right. I should have remembered that.
They went.
I knew it was recent, but not that recent.
They went to the first ever challenge when you drop off Batoka Gorge. They did that challenge
again. Yeah, Batoka, you're right.
They didn't go to Songwe Village, though. So you
Songwe
have...
Village is probably all condominiums now, anyway.
Probably, right. Leg six, almost halfway home. Austria or Switzerland?
I'll take Switzerland.
Switzerland?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Here we go. In a famous challenge from leg one of season 14 in Switzerland, teams had to transport how many pounds of cheese from the top of a hill to the bottom using traditional antique cheese racks.
That was hilarious. I love this.
A 100, B 200, C 300, or D 400?
Oh, wow. I remember it had to go up and down. A wheel of cheese must probably weigh 100 pounds. You think it weighs that much? Or 50 pounds?
Those were huge wheels.
Yeah. I can't weigh 100 pounds. Let's say if one wheel weighs 50 pounds, then they probably did it like four times.
Yeah, I don't remember. Honestly, I don't.
I'm going to take a while. It doesn't say it was 200 pounds.
You going to lock that in?
Yeah.
You originally thought it was 400 pounds.
I did.
Well, I'm glad you switched to 200. 200 is the right answer.
Woo! Oh, great. It helps to be a scientist.
That was the funniest. I mean, I felt bad for
that. That was really a great leg.
Congrats. You have made it to leg 7. You're halfway home.
Oh, it's just like All-Stars.
Right. So you could do better in the trivia department than you did on the race.
Yeah, ask me who got eliminated wearing a suit of armor.
Who got eliminated wearing a suit of armor?
Bill Bartek.
Leg 7. Turkey or Russia?
Ooh. I say Russia.
Going with Russia? All right.
You say Bill.
Yeah, Russia's fine.
All right. Here's your question. Leg 3 of season...
caviar.
Well, there was a caviar challenge. It wasn't in the season that I'm about to mention,
okay,
but...
Okay.
Leg 3 of season 9 in Moscow, Russia, featured which of these race elements? Double elimination, double yield, double length leg, or double roadblock?
I'd say double elimination. I think they were doing double eliminations then. Wasn't that the season where the guy lost his passport?
I think it was.
And that was one elimination. Maybe there was another one for somebody coming in last.
Go ahead, Joe.
Okay, I'm going to go for double elimination.
You locking that in?
Yeah.
Double elimination is not the right answer.
Oh, that's it.
Double length leg was the answer. The first double elimination technically on the race wasn't until season 10, following season.
Oh, okay.
We're one season off.
You're one season off.
What was the right answer at this one? Double what?
Double length leg.
I don't even know what that means.
I don't even remember that.
Oh, double length. That's right. Where Phil says
double length leg.
You're still racing.
Oh.
That's, I forgot that.
That was your fourth non-elimination, which means sadly, Joe and Bill, I am sorry to tell you, you've both been eliminated from the fast-paced race.
Aww. We're on a plane to
Billy is sitting here wearing a suit of armor, so we're out of the race.
Well, despite not making it to the finish line and being team number one, I hope you had fun.
That was fun.
Was very good.
And that was the game of the day, the fast-paced race. The fast-paced race.
I hope we didn't embarrass ourselves by doing so poorly.
No. But I'm taking you learned a lot more about the Amazing Race than you knew before the game started.
Yeah, for sure.
So next time you come on the game show, you know to study up for another Amazing Race trivia game.
You're on.
And I just thought of a good idea. How about after season 30 finishes, you two can come back on the game show as my guest, and we'll talk about the season as a whole.
Okay, sounds good.
Yeah, cool.
Well, I have had such a blast talking to you, Joe and Bill. This has been a true honor. Team Guido on the game show has been a bucket list thing of mine, and thank you so much for coming on the show with me.
Oh, you're welcome.
We loved every minute of it.
Us.
It's tremendous.
No, thank you. This has been such a pleasure. Thank you very much.
This has been a lot of fun. Thank you very, very much.
And I look forward to having you back on the game show again. You're always welcome.
Okay.
Anytime. Just let us know.
And here's to another 30 seasons of The Amazing Race.
And we'll be on 3 more times.
That's right, with me by your side, telling you all the trivia.
You got it. They're going to be a first team of 3.
That's right. Forget the regular 2, forget the family edition with the 4, teams of 3. Actually, now that I think of it, you know what would be a great Amazing Race season? If you had teams of 3, consisting of an all-star team and an Amazing Race superfan racing with them around the world. Now that's an idea we should suggest to CBS, don't you think?
I think it would be fabulous.
That would be wonderful. That'd be great. Will you go with us?
Yes.
You're on.
All right.
Yes. We'll make sure that third time's a charm, you're not going to get half a day behind.
Good deal. Good deal. Yes,
I'll make sure of it.
And we'll buy you a cowboy hat in advance.
Perfect. Well, thank you again, Joe and Bill. This was so much fun. Be well and take care.
Okay. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Well, that's going to do it for this episode of The Game Show. My thanks once again to Team Guido, Joe Baldassare, and Bill Bartek for being my guests today. And if you'd like to listen to the extended version of this episode, which includes more Amazing Race talk with Joe and Bill, plus the full Game of the Day segment, or if you'd like to listen to any of my previous episodes of the game show, log on to www.soundcloud.com/Bradley_Clark. That's Bradley_Clarke/sets/the game show. That's www.soundcloud.com/Bradley_Clarke. That's Bradley_Clarke/sets/the game show. And here's some last minute route info for all of you listeners. Be sure to not take a radio detour from WRHU so you can tune in next time for another exciting episode of the only talk show about the world of television game and competition shows, The Game Show. I'm Bradley Clarke, and I've got to go check into the pit stop. Bye for now.
This edition of The Game Show was created and produced by Bradley Clarke and was recorded at the WRHU studios. This is Austin Angelo speaking.
The Game Show is a Bradley Clarke production. Get your game on!